morning, everybody. Welcome to the Halfmoon Church of Christ Sunday service on January 10th. January 10th. I don't even know what day it is. January 10th, 2021. We're going to begin our service today by reading from the Psalms, and then we'll have several opening songs, opening prayer, and get right into worshiping God this morning. So this reading will be from Psalm number 146, verses 1 through 7. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. Put not your trust in princes, in the Son of Man, in whom there is no salvation. When his breath departs, he returns to the earth. On that very day his plans perish. Blessed is he whose help is the Lord of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, who keeps his faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry.
Okay, for our first song this morning, we'll be singing number 19, Come Thou Almighty King.
Come Thou Almighty King, help us Thy name to sing, help us to praise Thunder of glorious, Lord of victorious, come and reign over us, ancient of days. Come now, incarnate Word, gird on thy mighty sword, our prayer attend. Come and thy people bless, and give
shine on me.
Let's all pray together. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this time that we have together this morning as the body of Christ to sing songs to you, to offer up prayers, to study and hear from your word. Father, we ask that you bless the things we do this morning. Also, Father, bless those in our number who are not here today, those of our number who are traveling, those who have relocated temporarily for the winter. We ask that you watch over them, keep your loving arms around them. As we go forth this morning, Father, our prayer is that what we do today will glorify you as we praise you in song and in word. Thank you so much, Father, for your plan of salvation, for sending Christ to us. Thank you so much, Father, for the love and grace and mercy you give us that we don't deserve. And all of these things we ask of you in Christ's holy name.
Jesus, right on my heart and remind.
Philippians chapter 2, starting in verse 1. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to your own interests, but also the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant. Being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. As a family, we gather together every first day of the week. We gather together with a common love and a common Savior. As we think of Jesus and how he was just like each and every one of us, he gave up being with God for a while to come here on earth, to take the form of a man just like us, went through trials and temptations just like us, and yet was without sin. He was willing to go to the cross to take our sin upon himself. And that's why we, as we partake of the bread and partake of the cup, we're reminded of his body and his blood that was given for us and for our sins. Let us pray. Father, we are just so thankful for the willingness of your Son to die for our sins, Father, to die hanging on the cross, and unfortunately you having to turn away from him because of the sin that was nailed upon there. But we thank you, Father, for you raising him from the dead and for his willingness to be there in our place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. this time, we'll have a prayer for the offering. Father God, we thank you so much for all the blessings you give to us, the countless blessings. Father, we thank you for the ability to give back to you at this time, Lord. We just pray that we do so with a cheerful heart. We thank you for the blessings and the money that you provide for us and the ability to have roofs over our heads every night and the heat in the winter. And we pray that as we give back to you that your word will spread not only in Half Moon, but wherever is fitting. In Jesus' name we pray.
Lesson today, number 555.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you, singing
today. I hope I can get it to work. Oh, there it goes. Okay. The reading this morning is John 1, 1 through 5 and 9 through 13. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through him. And without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Who were born not of blood, nor of will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. The last sermon I gave, I also had this section, John 1 through 3 actually, as my reading. And this week, though, I would like to concentrate on the rest of that reading, which is 4 through 13, basically. John 1:4, God tells us, in the beginning, that is the Word in Him, that is the Word in Jesus Christ, the Creator of the universe, who was with God and was God, in Him was life. Therefore, in the beginning, before there was anything else but God, there was life. Think about that. The initial point I'd like to make this morning is that for us to see what real life is and where it comes from. And by the same token, what the Bible is mostly talking about when it speaks of real life, life in Christ. One of the great concepts that John's gospel gives us is this concept of life. Life is not only Christ's gift to us, but John tells us here in this verse that the Word Jesus is, in fact, life. He is alive. He's a living person, not a human person, but a divine person. He is alive and doing things like thinking, feeling, for all eternity, as far back as you can go, forever and ever and ever. There is one changeless reality, divine life, the original absolute reality is that in Him was life. Now, evolutionists say that physical matter gave rise to life, but if you read this verse, you'll see that the physical matter did not give rise to life, rather life gave rise to matter. At one time, there was only life and no matter. Then that divine personal life created matter. And then there was both life and matter. Here you see is the great division between the atheist world view and the Christian worldview, in that with atheists, everything begins with inanimate matter, and it's just there. There was nothing there before it to make it what it is. They say that the impersonal matter and impersonal energy are the original and the absolute, and they really accept that by faith. Then for billions of years, with no creator, no intelligence, no design, and no purpose or plan, there emerges a mindless, lifeless, random matter, not only the complexities of all biological systems, but ultimately this glorious thing that we call living people, living humans. And that's their account of how life came about. For Christians, it's much different. First, as John says, there was a spiritual life. Then physical matter and energy were created. First, there was a living creator. Then there was his creation. In the beginning was the Word, and in Him was life. Wherever you turn on this planet, you can see a living person. And you see an image of the absolute reality. The Word who was with God and was God and was life. In Genesis 2:7, God tells us, "Then the Lord God formed the man from dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature." You have never met an ordinary person. There are none. Every human being is extraordinary. They're amazing. And they're a reflection of the original reality that God, Jesus is life. They are extraordinary. but nearly all of them are dead. This, what we're talking about so far is physiological life, but that's not what John really is focusing on here when he talks of life. He writes, in him was life, but the life John really has in view is what the Bible calls new life, spiritual life, saving life, eternal life, the opposite of spiritual death and condemnation. That's the life John wants us to know about. That's why he wrote the gospel. The life he has in view is the life that we do not have naturally. Listen to John 5:24. Jesus says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but he has passed from death to life." If you walk with Jesus, if you pass, from the death into life. Apart from him, we are all dead. Apart from being in Jesus, we exist in a state of condemnation. In order to live forever and not come into judgment, we need his gift of eternal life, which is what John talks about here. That is, life is in Jesus. Here's what John 5:11-12 says. And this is the testimony that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son does not have life. In Jesus is life. So if you have him, you have life. If you reject him, you reject life. John 5:40 says, "You refuse to come to me that you have life." John 10:10 says, "I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." John 10:28 says, "I give them eternal life and they will never perish." So it's clear that when John says in 1:4, "In him is life," was life, he means spiritual life, eternal life, life that saves from judgment. But why does John go on to say in verse 4, "The life was the light of men"? Why does he say that? Because John, like Jesus, knew we as human beings don't really relate to what spiritual death and life really are until we relate them to something that we can more concretely understand. In the first century, things such as light and darkness or seeing and blindness were commonly used as metaphors for spiritual life and death. People aren't dead because they can't walk or talk or think or feel or even see with their eyes. They're dead because they cannot see their spiritual need and accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. They're dead because seeing, they do not see. They don't see Jesus as supremely valuable. They don't see his sacrifice as a precious gift. They're blind to their need to be in him, and they walk in darkness, and they are spiritually dead to this greatest of all realities. If they're going to see these things and receive them, they must be awakened and resurrect to the resurrected life that he offers. So John says in 4, "In him was life, and the life was the light of men." He's saying then, when death is replaced with life, man's darkness is replaced with light. In John 8:12, Jesus says, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. That's what John's talking about. The light of life is the light that comes with new life. When you receive Jesus, you receive this life. And when you receive life, you receive light. Now we come to verse 5. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. John's talking about Jesus coming into the world, and by coming into our world, he is coming into darkness. We're all dead, and we're in darkness. That's the condition of mankind until we have Christ. We have not passed from death to life or darkness to light. So Jesus comes into darkness as the light of the world, and John says, the darkness has not overcome it. That's what the ESV says. Other translations translate the word overcome as comprehend or understand. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not understood it. Just like many of our English words, there can be multiple meanings, so can the Greek words have multiple meanings. Excuse me. John says a similar statement also in 12, verse 35. The darkness did not grasp the light, that is, it did not overtake it. And the darkness did not grasp the light, that is, it didn't understand it. John may well have meant both of those aspects here. In verses 10 to 11, John clearly focuses on his message about when Jesus comes into the darkened world. Verse 10 says, he was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. This corresponds to verse 5, the darkness has not understood it. And verse 11 says, he came into his own, and his own people did not receive him. So the true light that came into the world that he made, and the people that he chose. So John clearly has in view here the whole world of human beings and the people of Israel in particular. The world belongs to Jesus. He made it. And Israel belongs doubly to Jesus. He made them and he chose them in the call of Abraham. When verse 9 says that when he came into the world, he gave light to everyone. Christ's life-giving life is offered to all as the only remedy to their state of darkness. As a timely analogy in today's terms, it's the same as if a doctor said, this COVID vaccine works for everyone. How do we understand that? By that statement, we would know that he means everyone who takes the vaccine. So, likewise, in verse 9, the phrase, the true light, means everyone who takes it, everyone who accepts it. Christ gives light for everyone who receives it. If you receive him, you accept him. Jesus imparts life. Which brings us then to the question, what does God do to keep the darkness of the world from overcoming the light? How does the light triumph in a world where everyone is dead and blind? Let's go to verse 12 to 13 in John 1. But to all who did not receive him, who did receive him, I'm sorry, but to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Jesus came into the world. He came to his own, and they did not receive him. They were dead and blind as to who he was. But eventually, some did receive him, and some believed in him. But who? The ones who eventually were born of God, not by bloodline, not of the will of the flesh, not of the will of man, but of God. They believed in Jesus. They accepted and submitted to who he was. And when they were reborn through his call, they came alive. They were raised into the light and given new life. They received him, and they became children of God. God's answer to the deadness and the blindness and the darkness of the world is the new birth. Remember what Jesus said to Nicodemus in John 3:3. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And in verse 5, unless one is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Everything hangs on being born again, because without this, we are dead and blind. So God's remedy for the blind and the dead world was to send Jesus into the world as the light and life, to lay down his life and to call people to be born again so that they can see him, receive him, and truly live in him. Salvation is the work of Jesus Christ. He sovereignly and graciously caused us to be born again. That is, he gave us life. John 1:4 says that in Jesus is life. So the way God gave us life was by uniting us with Christ. There is no saving life apart from Christ. So in the new birth, God unites us to Christ and brings us in Christ. The way we experience this new birth is the very act of coming alive. Our eyes are opened, we see Jesus for who he really is, and we receive him willingly. We call this faith, and by this union with Christ, by God's glory, we have what the Bible calls new life, eternal life. That's the way the new birth works. It imparts real life, and the meaning of that life is what it sees. But be aware, verse 4 says, in him is life. Life is never disconnected with Christ. Whoever has the Son has life. How do we have the Son? We receive him. Look again at verse 12. But to all who did not receive him, that is, believe on him, but to all who did not receive him, who believed in his name, who did receive him, believed in his name. The reason this is important is this. It teaches us that when Jesus commands us to believe on him for eternal life, we look steadfastly at Jesus, the Lamb of God, who laid down his life for us, and we realize the willingness to believe and receive him rising in our hearts is really a gift of God. And we acknowledge that belief in him and submitting to his call by repenting of our sins, by washing away our sins through baptism, and by committing ourselves to live forevermore in the light of Jesus Christ. The take-home message, really, that I want us to know and to remember is what he says in verse 4. In him was life, and the light was the light of men. Only in Jesus is eternal life, because only through him can our darkness be overcome with life and our blindness be replaced with light. Come to him, believe on him, and be in union with him, and he will be your life, and he will be your everlasting joy. If you have any prayers that you would like the church to take up while we sing this invitation song, please let it be known.
Sing to me of heaven, sing that song of peace from the toils that bind me, it will bring release. Burdens will be lifted that are pressing, so showers of great blessing o'er my heart will flow. Sing to me of heaven, let me finally of its golden glory, of its early gleam. Sing to me when shadows of the evening fall. Sing to me of heaven, sing the sweetest song of all. Sing to me when heaven, as I walk alone, dreaming of the
duration. So welcome back, brother. Lots of prayers were going out, that's for sure. Other announcements that, again, like I said, the bulletin has a complete list, but just a few highlights. Bob and Penny seem to be doing well. Penny is slowly recovering from the COVID virus. We did hear her voice on Wednesday during the Bible class. She was off camera a little bit, but she is home. And once their quarantine ends, because they're in northern Florida where their daughters live, they'll be heading down to the Tampa St. Pete area where they normally spend a few months during the winter. But please remember them in your prayers. The Reeve family, I guess the Reeves are ill today, so they are not here. So please pray for them that they'll get better and join us once again. Some sad news about young Lexi, who we've been praying for. This is a granddaughter of Bev's friends, their granddaughter. Her illness, she has cancer, like a neuroblastoma type of cancer. It's just getting worse. Everything that has been done for this young 3 years old, it just seems the tumors keep coming back. So unfortunately, Lexi's tumors have returned. One's on her spine, one's near the base of her brain. And so her parents continue to bring her to the medical center in Los Angeles where she gets treatment. It's a great burden on them because they also have a five-year-old. So they're trying to keep their family normal while they shuttle this child back and forth to the medical center. So please keep Lexi and her family in your prayers. Next Sunday is our congregational meeting. So please plan on several minutes after service next week so we can conduct a corporate business and kind of go over plans and vision for the coming year. Keith Caton was on Zoom on Wednesday night, and they are settled in and seem to be doing well in Virginia. Just wanted to mention that. Before we're dismissed, does anybody have anything else they want to bring before the body this morning? Okay, if not, let's go to God in prayer, and then we'll be dismissed. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you once again for setting this time aside for us to put our worldly cares out the door and to come together as a church family to worship you and to reflect on all the great things that you have done for us, especially sending your Son Christ to us. As we leave this place, Father, we ask that you be with us, that you keep your loving arms around us as we drive and commute on busy roads, as we interact with family, friends, and others. We always pray that you will be with us and guide us and direct us. Keep us safe, Father, during this pandemic time. Help us to utilize this time to good advantage. Thank you so much, Father, for the church family that we have, where we can love and support and pray for one another to try to keep things as normal as possible in our lives, that we will get through this episode and come out stronger on the other end. Thank you so much, Father, for loving us. Thank you for imbuing us with your Holy Spirit. Thank you for your wisdom and guidance. In Christ's name we pray.